My sin, oh morning.
Good morning.
Good to see you this morning. I ask you to stand as we open our service today.
Meeting is Saturday, August the 29th. Meeting in the library at 9:30 a.m. for breakfast, and then the meeting at 10. Don't forget about that. And then our meal of the month is a week from today. Are you ready for that?
Yes.
Just a week away. And so our theme this month is pasta. So we are inviting you to bring a pasta-themed meal and come and enjoy the food and the fellowship next Sunday following our service. Don't forget that this month, you'll hear about that again more here in a minute, but is a WMO, World Missions Offering. So we're encouraging you to be thinking about, praying about how God would have you to give to our World Missions Offering and help us meet our goal, our church goal of $5,000. And if I saw correctly, we're about halfway, almost halfway there. So we would love to exceed that goal. So pray about how God would have you to give in regards to that. Don't forget about our men's prayer time that meets prior to our Sunday morning service, in between Sunday school and just prior to this service starting. And they are going into the prayer room or into the library, whichever is necessary depending on the size of the group. young men and not as young men as well are invited. So we certainly encourage you to be a part of that prayer time as they meet and pray for the service, for the power of God to be real and to be poured out in our service, and that is so important. I believe that prayer is so essential to not only our individual Christian life, but the success and the growth and development of the church. Amen?
Amen?
And after all, this is called to be a house of prayer, so prayer should be not a secondary thing, but a primary thing. Prayer shouldn't be something that we beg and plead for people to do. Prayer should be something that we love to do and look forward to an opportunity to do. And so prayer time happens prior to our service, and then on Tuesday mornings, a group of men, we get together, we meet back here in the overflow area. It is air conditioned, I will tell you that. And we pray about the individual needs that are on our hearts or those that we've been made aware of in our church or in extended church family. And we really, really like to get serious about those spiritual needs. So if you're aware of those prayerful needs you would like to make known to us, then either write them down, email, or text us. And we would love to pray about your situation as well on Tuesday mornings. And we invite any and every man who would like to be here and can, Tuesday mornings at 9 a.m. And we won't embarrass you, we won't hurt you, but we promise it'll provide an opportunity for you to deepen your faith, enrich your prayer life, and really grow in the Lord. So it's an opportunity for you again, Tuesday mornings at 9 a.m. Prayer is the theme, it seems, this morning. There's a lot of attention in the church, not just in our church, but in the church in general, towards prayer, especially with all that's going on in our world today. And so you're going to hear a little bit more about prayer opportunities. Brother Doug, would you stand for a moment if you would, Brother Doug? All right. Do you want to say something? You need a mic? Here, let me give you a mic. Yeah, everybody can hear you good. All right. We're delighted to have Brother Doug with us. Go ahead, you can come up here if you want.
Well, I started an organization called the Brazos Valley Coalition for a Christian Worldview. And I'd like all y'all to join if you're interested. The first event we're going to have is on 9/11 at noon. Brother Dustin, let's use his church here. And the idea is to pray for this Brazos Valley, pray for America. We're going to have a series of five prayers, probably 10 minutes of length each one. First one is going to be a call for repentance. Probably Brother Doug and Bill has been making it do that one. Then a call for then a prayer for the church. We become men and women that God wants us to be in this crazy world we live in where Satan's on the loose and he seems to be getting worse and worse. We need to all, including me, stand up and be bigger Christians, bold, fearless, like God wants us to be, and be the salt and light that he called us to be. Three, we want to pray for the children, young adults, teenagers, going back to school. Arrington, tell you, others in this church with COVID-19. In fact, Arrington just told me one of the teachers at his school, College Station High School, came down with COVID-19, so maybe people might be quarantined because of that. But let's pray for them. We want to pray for our first responders, our first-line workers that are working on the front lines. We want to pray for law enforcement, for the rule of law, and our Constitution that gives us our rights. And finally, we want to pray for just for revival in America, and for God's will. So I vision a series of monthly or quarterly meetings like that, and maybe we can meet and advocate for godly principles and public policy and things like that. We want to start with prayer, intercessory prayer and repentance. So that's what it is, 911 emergency call to God for the Brazos Valley, for our nation right here in this church.
Amen. Yeah. There is a poster back there on the bulletin board, and we're delighted to have Dr. Doug with us, and certainly we appreciate his vision on this as we've been, again, meeting. He's been part of our, faithfully been a part every week of our Tuesday morning prayer meeting. And back a few weeks ago, he started, the Lord had just given him this idea and vision and passion about having a prayer meeting, a area-wide prayer meeting. And obviously, it just kind of developed. He's been talking about it, thinking about it, praying about it. And so now he's put it to a date and got a plan together. And I have a copy of the flyer here. Mine's black and white. The one on the bulletin board, I think, is color. But please take a look at that again. That is 9/11, September the 11th at noon. So I want to encourage you to come and be a part of that prayer time. Yes?
I'd like to have five different pastors and different churches involved. Brother Doug being the central one, I want to have a media here. Russell, we put it online, I think, on our...
That's plain, yes, sir.
On YouTube. Mm-hmm. But if you know somebody who might want to do one of the prayers, about 10 minutes each, please let me know after church, or sooner than later. I'm going to be asking other pastors that I know around the community, but we want really strong leaders to get up and lead these prayers. I believe God will hear it.
Amen.
If all of us will join and just be here, maybe even fast that one before you come.
Amen.
That'd be great.
So essential. I appreciate that. And again, that was birthed right here in these prayer meetings on Tuesday mornings. And so thankful for what God is doing. And I'm excited about the potential prospects of that. So I want you to be praying about that 9/11 prayer ceremony and how that you can be a part of that as well. And then let me encourage you in closing for you to go to nafwb.org. And then you can select the Jeremiah 29 Project. It's something that our national office is encouraging and promoting. And that's for every individual and for the family. The Jeremiah 29 Project, our initiative, is to build, plant, and pray. And the cornerstone of this project that they are just now kicking off is prayer. Yet again. And I don't have the time to present everything. I could read this whole blog to you, but we don't have the time to do all that. But I did want to encourage you to go to that, sign up for that, get involved in that. What they're encouraging the families to do is to, number one, in this time of crisis and pandemic and the change and the election that's all coming up and all that's going on in our world with all the rioting and the hatred and all that stuff, is to pray, pray, pray. But don't be idle. Don't just sit back and do nothing, but to build. Get busy doing the work that God's given us to do now, and to plant, and that is to plant, to invest, and to continue doing what God would have us to do as a family, and not just wait for things to change, and then pray, 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 pray. And as part of the Jeremiah 29 initiative, what they're asking you to do as an individual and as a family is, first of all, in September, if I've got this order right, is to spend at least sometime, preferably 15 minutes or more, reading the Bible every day. So they ask you to commit to spending 15 minutes a day reading the Bible. And then in October, they're going to ask the people to pray for 15 minutes a day. So 15 minutes reading the Bible a day. And then in October, spend 15 minutes a day in prayer. And then in November, they're challenging the families to focus on spending time together in the Word as a family. And so you can see that there's a beautiful plan that they have for this, and that is to build and unite the family and the kingdom of God, to help us all be more in tune to what God is wanting to do in these times of crisis that we are facing. Instead of just sitting idly by and waiting for things to happen, it is to be active and to give God an opportunity to work in your lives. And so let me encourage you to do that. Be mindful of those. These are wonderful opportunities for you as an individual believer and as a part, a participant of this church, to see God do great things in our midst. Are you excited about the prospect of those things? I know I am. I hope you'll get on board and involved. Obviously, it's up to you. There's no obligation, but we encourage you to get involved and see what God can do in your midst. All right, well, if you will, let's take a moment and stand and go. You've been sitting for a while. Let's stand and go to the Lord in prayer. All right, let's pray. Father, we do certainly want to take a moment to thank you for loving us. Thank you for your goodness and your faithfulness to us, Lord. Thank you, though, Lord, even though we fail you so often, your love is faithful, you do not change, and your love is unconditional. And you are willing, Lord, to embrace us and to restore us and to forgive us if we come to you and confess our sins and repent and seek your face. God, I know that we are in a time of great need in our world. There's so many issues that we are facing, so many crises. And Lord, the reality is there is a great spiritual battle that is taking place for the individual soul of every believer and certainly for the church and the family. And God, I think it is a great opportunity and it is a challenge and a time for us as followers of Christ to rise up, to stand strong, to be faithful, even as we've been studying in our Sunday school classes, Lord, and to follow through and to follow you regardless of the price, the consequences, Lord, just leaving that all up to you. And Lord, just allow you to work in their midst and in our lives. And I believe that you have a great plan for the church to really shine brightly in these dark days and to make a huge impact in our world. But it's also an opportunity, if the devil has his way, for us to be silenced, for us to do nothing, for us to just be idle, complacent, and just sit back and wait. And God, we will miss what you have in store for us. Lord, initially, I remember when all of this started with COVID-19, my concern and my prayer was that we as a church do not miss what you want to teach us and you want to do in us and through us during this time. And God, some of that is starting to be revealed. I pray you would help us to be bold and help us to be faithful, help us to trust you, help us to follow you, and help us, Lord, to be willing to stand, even if it means independently, and to do, Lord, what you would have us to do. Help us, Lord, as a body of believers, as a church, to rise up and truly be the family of God and be a house of prayer. May you bless and anoint these prayer initiatives and actions. And God, I pray that you would, as I know you will, honor those prayers. You said in your word, if my people will humble themselves and pray and seek my face, then, Lord, you will hear our prayers. And I know you want to do that. We need to pray. We need to humble ourselves, turn from our wicked ways, and turn to you, O God, and I know you will move in mighty ways. And I know you desire to do that. Help us. Help us, Lord, get that vision of what you want to do in our midst and help us to just faithfully follow through. Light a fire. Bring revival. Lord, may it start right here in my heart and in my life and my family, and may it spread throughout this church and in this community and in our country and in this nation, in this world. And God, may you be exalted. May you bless the songs of the service this morning. Bless the reading and the teaching of your word. The baptism here just a little while as Miss Cynthia comes to be baptized. We're excited about what you're doing. God, may you help us not to just get a little emotional, but help us to put into action and be faithful and follow you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. God bless you. Please be seated.
Begin our song service this morning with number 422 in the hymnal, A Hill Called Mount Calvary, number 422. comments a little bit faster. Solid Rock, number 419.
My name is Ryoko, and today I want to share with everyone my hope story. So recently I got baptized and everyone celebrated for me and welcomed me into the church family. It was a special day where I declared my faith in Christ publicly. I truly believe that God is always there for you through difficult times and His kingdom is full of love and joy. I'm so truly happy that I decided to have faith in Christ. I also believe that God gives you trials in life to help us learn new things. There was a period of my past where I didn't have any friends. There were all these cliques and I did not feel invited. And I felt really miserable and worthless and hopeless and depressed and all these negative things at the same time. And I just felt really sad. But then I attended Hope Alive service and I met Heath and Joni, and their service was full of kind and encouraging words that uplifted my mental health. I truly believe that hurtful words can really damage a person's mental health, but God's words are so uplifting. And now that I've made friends at Hope Alive, I feel that God wants me to appreciate and be thankful for the things that He provides for us. I'm so happy that my mental health has become so much better, and I want to continue to strengthen my faith in Christ. This is my hope story. Thank you so much.
Stand as we go to our final song, number 418, I Know Whom I Have Believed. 418, we'll sing verses 1, 2, and 5.
Some through the fire, but
There's coming a time soon, though, when we're going to do that anyway. Amen? I'm getting tired of this, aren't y'all? But anyway, we're delighted to have our visitors. There are visitor slips in the back of the pew in front of you. And if you're a first-time visitor, if you'll fill that out and let us have a record of your attendance, we really would appreciate that. And then let me just say, for the sake of those who don't know or aren't familiar with, we will have an opportunity for you to give in the offering with your tithes and offerings at the end of our service. We will not pass the plates. We will have our ushers placed at strategic places so that you can give in the offering and not have to worry about the possible transmission of germs or anything like that. So we just want you to be aware that that will be provided. And we are certainly looking forward to our baptism at the end of service. It's good to see all these young people in here today too. Amen. I love seeing all these young. I know normally, and maybe starting back up in October, we'll have children's church. The kids will be going back over into children's church. But I love seeing them in church, too.
Amen.
And them learning to worship and sit and participate and be a part of the service. Isn't that good?
Yeah.
I love it. Love it. Love it. Got some great kids. Good to see their smiles and their energy. All right. Well, if you haven't already, turn in your Bibles to Colossians chapter 2. We're looking at verses 11 through 15 in our message today. I've titled the sermon, Paid in Full. Paid in Full.
Amen.
And if you have any kind of spiritual inclination, you know where this is probably headed, so you can already get excited. Amen? Because we know what truth that this passage represents. Well, in last week's message, we saw Paul presenting Jesus as our sufficient Savior. And it's so good to see that. Amen?
Amen?
In today's text, it's a continuation of that very important truth and message. So let's read verse 11 through 15 and get started. And again, if you don't have a Bible, please be aware that they will be listed up here on the wall behind me. You're certainly welcome to follow along with us either way you prefer. All right, Colossians chapter 2, beginning verse 11. You were also circumcised in Him with a circumcision not done with hands, by putting off the body of the flesh in the circumcision of Christ. Now, pause for a second. Remind me again, who is Paul writing to? The believers, the Christians in the church in Colossae. Okay, so he's not writing to the lost, he's writing to the believers. And he's trying to encourage them and keep them on track, help them to avoid the distortions, the lies, and the heresies that are being presented around them and even in their midst, trying to keep them on track with the Word of God and stay faithful to Jesus Christ and have a deeper appreciation and understanding of what He has done and is doing for them. In continuation, verse 12, when you were buried with Him in baptism. Isn't it interesting that on this day we're reading this text, we're having another baptism. I'm excited about that because we get to see an expression in fulfillment of what is being told or demonstrated in these verses. Yeah. In which you were also raised with Him through faith in the working of God, who raised Him from the dead. And when you were dead in trespasses and in the uncircumcision of your faith or flesh, He made you alive with Him and forgave us all our trespasses. Isn't that good news?
Yeah.
He erased the certificate of death with its obligations that was against us and opposed to us, and has taken it all away by nailing it to the cross. Woo! That's good. He disarmed the rulers and authorities and disgraced them publicly. He triumphed over them in Him. Now, I'm probably not going to get to verse 15 in the message, so let me just in summary say what this represents is this idea of victory and a demonstration of the victory as they would normally come through and say, let me show you what we've done, what we've accomplished through the crowds, through town. And this is what He is saying right here is what Jesus has done and is going to do. He is trying to demonstrate the power, the authority, and the total victory that He has accomplished in this parade, if you will. All right, so in our text that we just read, verse 11 through 15, Paul uses, I want to point out, three different images or illustrations or symbolisms in our text to illustrate and to express the believer's deliverance from sin. And the key is He wants you to understand what Jesus does for you and how He delivers you in totality from sin. Isn't that good?
Amen.
Not what you do, but what He does, what He has already done, and what He offers us. So the first point I want you to see is in the first illustration that we see in our text is seen in verse 11, and that is circumcised in Christ. Circumcised in Christ. Now, if you read all the way back in Genesis chapter 17, you read where God made the covenant with Abraham. And in this covenant, there was a requirement for the Jewish males on the eighth day after their birth to undergo this circumcision, this physical circumcision. And it was a demonstration and a declaration of that family's faith in God. You understand? That was a way of them connecting to this covenant that God had made with Abraham. So circumcision can be seen in two different ways. I want to demonstrate for you in this message today. Number one, the obvious, and that is a physical meaning. It has a physical meaning and a physical representation. The physical was the cutting away of the foreskin. The Jewish teachers, though, began to insist and teach of the necessity of this literal circumcision in order to be saved. Now, what I'm saying by that is what later on these Jewish teachers began to practice and insist and teach is that the only way that anyone can truly be right with God is that they go through this physical circumcision. In other words, they were saying that it is necessary for you to do this physical work in order for you to gain righteousness and favor with God. What we call that is a works salvation. That was not what God intended. That is not biblical. Let me just go ahead and stress and say, clearly there is nothing that you and I or I can do to earn or merit our salvation or favor with God.
That's right.
We can do nothing in the way of gaining favor with God and getting our sins forgiven and being righteous in and of ourselves. It's not upon us to do. It's not about our works. And so in Acts chapter 15, we read of Paul and Barnabas going to Jerusalem because there were some people there that were teaching that the Christian believers, some of these Jewish, again, leaders were teaching that these Christian believers who were coming into the faith, they were being converted. And what they were teaching is they were Gentiles, they needed to be circumcised in order to be saved. So see, this false teaching continued from the Old Testament all the way back even to the New Testament in the day of Paul and Barnabas. And they confronted this teaching. They went to the apostles and they said, hey, this is what's going on. We got a problem with this. Because this is not consistent with what Jesus has done and what we find true in the Gospels. And so, the Pharisees that were part of that group, that were part of the leaders in the church there in Jerusalem, they agreed even with this idea about these Gentiles needing to go through this physical circumcision to be saved. Then if you'll remember, Peter stood up in the midst, bold, brave, and spontaneous Peter, he stood up and he said, wait a minute now. He shared that the Gentiles needed to, that would hear the gospel and believe, that would put their faith in Jesus. He said that God knew their heart and they were saved by the same grace and through faith, just like everybody else there.
Yeah.
In other words, what he said was it wasn't by their works of circumcision that they were saved, that it was only through their faith in Jesus Christ that gave them salvation.
Amen.
He defended the simple doctrinal truth that was being distorted and had been for eons, if you will. And so Peter stood in opposition to this false teaching as well. Unfortunately, though, many people then, and even many people today, depend on their physical actions and on rituals, traditions, and ceremonies to get salvation and to get righteousness from God. And what we see in this text and what we saw demonstrated in the Bible is that that does not work. Amen?
Amen.
So it's not, though, this message is not so all about what doesn't work. So bear with me. We're not done. That's just the start. Okay? So that was the physical meaning of the circumcision. Now let's look secondly at the spiritual meaning, the symbolic representation of this text. Okay? And so it was a cutting away, not so much just from the flesh as the physical meaning was, but from the heart. Not done by, as Paul said, by hand, by man, but by God. It was a spiritual act and not a physical act. Now, I want to share with you several key verses that are essential to your understanding of this truth that I'm trying to present. So I'm going to give you several verses. They're going to be listed behind me, okay? And you can make notes, you can look at these later, but certainly please follow along with me. The first one is Deuteronomy chapter 10 and verse 16. Deuteronomy 10, 16 says, therefore, circumcise not your flesh, but your hearts, and don't be stiff-necked any longer. So what we see even all the way back in the Pentateuch, in Deuteronomy, we see that circumcision could be used symbolically. And it was a representation of a spiritual action and not just the physical action. See how quickly and how easily we as men mess things up. God intends to do things, and he often uses a physical motion or act to demonstrate what he really wants to accomplish spiritually. And we get so stuck in the physical and we think that it's up to us to do it to accomplish righteousness. And we blow it because we can never get there that way. Deuteronomy again, chapter 30, verse 6 says, the Lord your God will circumcise your heart and the hearts of your descendants. And you will love him with all your heart and all your soul, that so you will live. And so what he's saying there is, because of the work that God does in your heart, you grow in your love for Him and you live for Him. It's not what you do, but it's what God accomplishes internal. He cuts away the sinful natural man and from your heart, and then He makes you that spiritual man in tune to the things of God. A hunger and a thirst for righteousness, if you will. Well, continuing. Ezekiel chapter 44 and verse 7 says, "When you brought in foreigners, uncircumcised in both heart and flesh, to occupy my sanctuary, you defiled my temple while you offered my food, the fat and the blood." And listen to what he says in closing. He says, "You broke my covenant by all your detestable practices." So what he's saying is, people can not only be physically unclean by their actions and their sinful deeds, but they certainly can be spiritually unclean, because they're not right with God and they haven't come and allowed Him to perform that spiritual cleansing and circumcision. Then in Acts chapter 7, verse 51. Acts 7, 51. And this is part of Stephen's sermon. It's a powerful message. Read through the whole chapter, man. It's a long message. You think I preach long sometimes. I bet you this one went longer than I go in person. It had to be a long message. It's a whole long... Anyway... So I'm not going to give you the whole thing, but just verse 51, he says to this group, he says, and this is pretty bold, okay? He's not coddling them. He's not just, you know, petting them and patting them on the back and tickling their ears. He's just shooting it straight. He's telling the truth, okay? And he says, "You stiff-necked people with uncircumcised hearts and ears, You are always resisting the Holy Spirit as your ancestors did, you do also." Wow. That's pretty bold, amen? That's not beating around the bush. That's just getting right to the truth and just telling it like it is. And what he's saying is, you are lost because, spiritually speaking, you are uncircumcised. You are not seeking for the things of God. You haven't allowed God to change and transform your heart. Man, what a bold statement.
Yeah.
What a bold statement. Well, then finally, Romans chapter 2, verse 28 and 29. Romans 2, 28 and 29. Paul, writing to the church in Rome, says, "For a person is not a Jew who is one outwardly, and true circumcision is not something visible in the flesh." Notice he said true circumcision, because again, their emphasis was on the physical aspect of circumcision. In other words, that the male had to be circumcised. He said that's what their concentration was, and that's what they thought made you a Jew. If you were an outsider, you came in, the only way it was complete and you were completely converted was if you were circumcised. And Paul says, no. True circumcision is not something visible in the flesh. On the contrary, in verse 29, he says, a person is a Jew or a child of God who is one inwardly, and circumcision is of the heart. What God does in your heart, by the Spirit, not the letter. That person's praise is not from people, but from God. Man, isn't that good?
Amen.
So what he's saying is, you're distorted in your view, your perception of things. You think it's all about what you do. And what Paul says, it's about what he did. You think it's about you going and doing this and that. Well, if I can just do something to earn my salvation, Paul says, no, you can't do anything to earn your salvation. What you do is let God do the work in your heart. He does it. Listen, you can change certain ways. You can turn over a new leaf. You can stop bad practices and addictions and all sorts of troubles. Okay? But I want to tell you what, there's nothing like the power of God that truly sets you free.
Amen.
And what Paul is talking about is not you trying to make changes, but you just go to God and you say, "I'm broken. I'm sinful. I am in need of your redeeming work. Would you just come and transform my life?" And then he cuts away the old sinful man and he makes you new. That's the circumcision, the spiritual imagery that Paul gives for the church in Colossae. And for us as believers today, he said, that's what Christ wants to do for you. You can't do it. He can do it. All right, that's what we see in this circumcised in Christ. In saying this, Paul was likely, of course, challenging the Gnostics, as we talked about before, who were requiring the Christians to be circumcised. Jewish laws, of course, were a part of this problem and struggle that that Paul was dealing with in the church as well. So we need to understand that when we are saved, the Lord Jesus comes in and He circumcises our heart, cuts away that sin, and makes us new. That's what He does for us. Number two, baptized in Christ. It's the second imagery or symbolism that Paul has here. Baptized in Christ. That's the one we're going to see in a physical way being demonstrated at the end of our service today. So we're excited about that. We see that in verse 12. Paul not only talked about being circumcised, but then he talks about the baptism. Baptism has, like circumcision, both a physical, a literal representation and application, and then a figurative and spiritual or symbolic as well representation. We see both of those in this text and in the Scripture. Now, let's first look, like we did in the circumcision, at the physical meaning of this as Paul addresses the crowd. First of all, the physical representation and aspect of baptism. That's where a person hopefully has already made a decision for Jesus Christ and they come to a pastor, a minister, and then they are baptized. It means that they are immersed in water and then raised up out of the water. Now, I got to tell you clearly, as Free Will Baptists, we don't believe, and I'll get into this more later on, but we don't believe in sprinkling. I mean, unless you're sitting on the front row during the preaching. That's the only sprinkling you're going to get. But what we believe is baptism by immersion, and that's following a person's decision to believe in, trust, and to follow Jesus Christ. Amen?
Amen?
But the physical act is where that person is lowered in that water and raised up. Arrington had that happen last week. Last week the water was cold, Arrington. I'm sorry, man. I didn't have the heat up enough. I figured out what happened. Cynthia, it's nice and warm in there, so you don't have to experience the cold that he had last week. All right? It's a physical act. It's a physical demonstration. And we get excited when we see that because of the symbolism in the spiritual sense. But on the physical side, what we read about, first of all, of course, is John the Baptist. And he was baptizing people in the Jordan River. Remember that? And then, of course, as John was teaching and preaching and baptizing, no other than Jesus Christ Himself came for John to baptize him. And John resisted at first and said, No, I'm not worthy to baptize you. But Jesus insisted, you need to do this. Because Jesus was modeling for us, set an example for us as believers to do as well. It's an important part of our obedience. Understand, it's about obedience.
Yeah.
We'll say more about what it isn't, but it was an act of obedience. So it's a physical act that is important for us as believers to do, to obey Jesus Christ. So Jesus then directed the apostles and the church to go, remember, in Matthew chapter 28, go and make disciples, and then what did He say at the tail end of that? Not that it was insignificant, not that it was later because it was less important, but discipling them and then baptizing them. Baptizing them, and He said specifically, gave instructions on how to do it. And you notice that's what we do here, and that is in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. It's what Jesus taught the church to do. Do this physical baptism in this way.
Yeah.
There's no biblical example of any sprinkling going on. It's about take them down and bring them up. Amen?
Yeah.
Well, typically in the New Testament, when a person came to salvation in Jesus, they were baptized right afterwards. You read in the Bible about the story of Philip and the eunuch. And remember in the chariot? Remember how God miraculously took Philip there? And then he got to share as the eunuch was reading from Isaiah, and then he got to share the gospel and what it really meant. And the Spirit of God quickened the eunuch. He became a believer. And Philip was able to lead him to Christ in salvation. And then he says, what's stopping us from being baptized? So immediately when they came to water, what did they do? Not 6 months later, not 6 years later, not whenever it was convenient. When they got to where there was water, they were immediately ready to be baptized. Amen? When Paul was miraculously, you remember when he and Barnabas, when they were in the jail cell and they were worshiping God even though they had been beaten and all of those things, and the earthquake came and the jail was flung open and their chains fell off. And remember when the jailer came and he saw that what had happened, he was about to kill himself. But then Paul said, no, 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 we're all here, don't harm yourself. And then what happened ultimately that followed is the jailer came to Christ. He put his trust in Jesus Christ. He went home and all of his family, the Bible says, became believers in Christ. Isn't that good? They all trusted in Jesus.
Yeah.
And so what happened? 6 months later, they all, no, 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 no. Then immediately they got baptized. Can you imagine? Hey, it's 2 o'clock in the morning. Let's go down the river and get baptized. I don't know what time it was. Wouldn't that be great? Now, we do it here on Sunday mornings because it's convenient. We're all together. But wouldn't it be wonderful if sometime we just had a whole slew of people want to be baptized and we just said, hey, we're going to have a service. Y'all come on, gather in. Wait, it ain't Sunday. It don't matter. Come join us anyway. Amen? Wouldn't that be great? Because I got saved and I want to be baptized right now.
Yeah.
Well, see, we don't necessarily follow the Bible. We think this is the way to do it. We got to do it always on a Sunday morning. Listen, I've told people I'll baptize you on a Sunday night, a Monday night, a Tuesday night, or a Saturday morning. It don't matter. Amen?
Amen?
We want to follow the biblical model and example. Now, we'll talk more about that as we get to Cynthia's baptism later on. But this is what happened in the New Testament. Baptism was an act of obedience of a believer, and it was symbolic demonstration of what Christ had already performed in that new believer's heart. Understand that. So, let's look then at the spiritual or the figurative meaning of that baptism. It's important. Paul's presented here in our text. We need to understand what he's saying. So when a person is baptized, again, by immersion, they are identifying themselves with the death and the burial and the resurrection of Jesus Christ their Lord.
That's right.
And that's so important for us to understand. Well, why in the world do they dip you in water? So they clean you up? No. Well, it's a representation of the cleaning that Christ has already done.
Yeah.
Amen?
Amen.
Now, some people have this mentality that I need to go get baptized so I can be saved. No, listen. You don't get saved by baptism.
That's right.
That's part of the teaching here in this passage of Scripture, is to understand what baptism is and what it isn't. Baptism is not a tool or a means or a process by which a person is saved.
Right.
Baptism is an action that is following after a person has made a decision to put their trust and faith in Jesus Christ.
Amen.
It is apart from their salvation, and it has nothing really to do with the salvation other than it is a physical demonstration of what has already taken place on the inside.
Right.
And if you do it for any other reason, then it's a wasted effort.
Yeah.
Baptism does not save you, or really even, I would say, gets closer to God. But there's a wonderful experience, and it's a great liberating feeling when you make that public expression and demonstration of your faith before your church body and say, I'm telling you by my actions that I am identifying with the death, the burial, and the resurrection of Jesus Christ. I want you to know I love Him, and I'm going to live for Him, and this is how I'm telling you that right here, right now. And there's just something encouraging and uplifting and just inspiring and motivating about it, not only for the one being baptized, but for those who are participating by viewing it as well.
Amen.
Amen. So, in keeping with this idea and speaking about baptism, you notice that when I baptize a person prior to me raising their hand to their mouth, which is our typical procedure, I raise my right hand and I say, I baptize this, my brother, and you'll see it in a few moments, I baptize this, my brother or my sister, in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Again, just as Jesus said in Matthew chapter 28. And then as they are baptized, or as they are lowered in the water, you notice, maybe you don't hear it because sometimes maybe there's noise and then there's the splash of the water. But if you'll catch it, always, always say, lowered in the likeness of His death and raised in the likeness of His resurrection. Because that's exactly what baptism is. It is a physical demonstration, but it is a representation, a symbolism of what Christ has already done in us, and that we are identifying ourselves with His work. We are saying that I am dying to myself, and I am coming up out of this water a new person in Christ, and I am identifying with His death, His burial, His resurrection, and I have new life in Him. That's what that rising up out of that. Now, you don't get that by sprinkling. How in the world is there anything representative of the baptism that Jesus performed and that he directed his disciples and apostles to do out of somebody sprinkling water or pouring water over your head? You don't get it. That's not the symbolism. And it is so important because the symbolism is significant. Now remember again, it is symbolism. That process, whether it is sprinkling or pouring or dipping, either one, has nothing to do with you being saved other than the fact you should already be saved. Hello? Amen?
Amen.
Now, that means that we are symbolically dying to ourselves and sin and raised up in new life of Christ, as in Romans 6:3. Listen to what it says. Or are you unaware that all of us who were baptized into Christ were baptized into His death? And then Galatians chapter 3, verse 27 says, for those of you who were baptized into Christ have been clothed with Christ. And so what he's saying is this represents what Christ has already done in your life. And there's an identification by your action with the work that Christ has already performed. The water baptism, like circumcision, is symbolic. It does not have any spiritual power to change your life. It is our faith in Christ that is essential to salvation, as Paul said in our text, Colossians chapter 2, verse 12. As God raised Christ, though, from the dead, He gives us new life, eternal life, through Christ, and that's what it represents. And when I'm speaking with someone to make sure that they understand what baptism is, whether it's a child or an adult or whatever, one of the things that I picked this up, I just got the idea a long time ago, and I was like, how can I help them to get an imagery, a real representation of what baptism is and what it isn't? And the idea came to me with the wedding band. And so I always will ask them, after they've already had their discipleship lessons, after they've already gone through that, and before the baptism takes place, then I will say, okay, I want to make sure you understand what baptism is and isn't. And I'll say, well, what is this on my hand? And they obviously say, well, that's a wedding ring. I said, well, what does it mean? I said, it means I'm you're married. I said, okay, that's right. So what if I take it off and don't wear it? And all of a sudden, they, you know, especially the kids, they look like, wait a minute, you trying to trick me? I say, well, what does it mean? And I'm not really trying to trick them. I'm trying to make sure they understand. And they say, every once in a while somebody say that you're not married. I said, no, it really doesn't mean that, because all this is a symbol. When we see this ring, it says to us that person is probably married, because when they get married, they exchange rings and we wear the ring as a representation to everybody else. Hey, that person's married. But if you take the ring off and don't ever wear it, it doesn't mean you're not married. It just means you're not wearing the symbol. Amen? And it doesn't mean you're not devoted. It doesn't mean you don't love your wife. It just means you don't have that symbol. But now, if I take this ring and I lose it, or if I give it to a kid and the kid wears it, does that mean that kid's married? No, we're not Muslims. We don't practice that. Amen?
Amen.
Some of y'all thought that was fun. Alright. But no, that's not what it means. Just because a kid's wearing a ring does not mean that it is that they are married. What it means is they're wearing somebody's wedding band. That's all that it means. It doesn't change anything. It just means they're wearing somebody's wedding band. This is a symbol, and it doesn't change the reality. It represents a reality that hopefully has already taken place. And that's what baptism is. Baptism doesn't change the reality. Baptism is a physical demonstration of the reality that's already taken place, the change, the transformation that Christ has already made in our hearts and our lives. And we are identifying with Him. We're saying, I want to continue with this going forward. Amen?
Amen.
So, it is an individual choice too, by the way. That's one of the reasons why we don't practice anything about baby or infant baptism. Now, I'm not going to pick on Christina. And she meant well. She didn't know. But back when, after she first came and she got saved, and the Lord was doing a work of transformation in her heart, man, she wanted to give it all to God. Amen. I commend her for that. She still is like that. She's learning and growing. But then immediately she's like, well, man, I need to do something with my kids. So she wanted to get her child baptized, you know. And I said, well, I appreciate that intention and that effort, but we don't baptize kids. Not unless they're old enough to have made a decision to follow Christ. And the reason is because, again, baptism is a symbol of what somebody has already experienced. And a kid, who is so young cannot understandably choose to put their trust in Jesus. You understand?
Yeah.
They need to, whatever age, whether now some kids, maybe at 4 or 5, they if they've come to that awareness, the Spirit of God has quickened their soul and they're ready to be saved, then praise God. I don't put a limit on it. No, you got to be, I've heard parents say, no, you ain't old enough to do that. You got to be at least a teenager. That's shameful. I'll tell you, two of my kids, Alex was 5 and Lizzie was 6 when they both clearly gave testimony of the transformation of Christ at work in their heart and they wanted to be baptized. Amen? 5 and 6, and I have no doubts. None, zero whatsoever. Amen?
Yeah, amen.
And so I don't limit that, but I do say I'm not going to baptize a child unless we have some representation of the fact that they have made that decision, put their trust in Christ, and they understand what baptism is and isn't. And then, if they're willing and they're ready and their parents are okay with it, then we do the baptism.
Yeah.
That's why we practice it that way. Because we want to honor what is taught in the Word. It's not about what feels good. It's not about making a parent feel good. It would have been so easy to say, well, yeah, we'll have a secret ceremony. We'll pour some water on that kid's head. We'll make you feel good as a mom. That might have made her feel good, but that's not teaching her the truth. Amen?
Amen.
So what's imperative for her is a parent to understand that she live in such a way that she raises that child in the Word of God, in the house of God, and then that child comes up to a point where he understands and he accepts Christ as his Savior, and then he wants to follow mom's example. Amen?
Amen.
Now, we need to move because we're out of time. And point number 3 is banking in Christ. You said, wait a minute, I didn't read anything in there about banking. All right. The first one was circumcision, second one was baptism, and third one is banking. This is the most important part, but everything leads to it, and everything represents this. And it all ties together. There's no separate part. This is all integral. And so in verse 13 through 15, we have this imagery of banking in the Bible. As Paul writes to the Colossian believers. The first thing that we see is number 1, or letter A, is we owed a debt we could not pay.
Right.
We owed a debt that we could not pay. W.A. Criswell said, the apostle says that this whole world is one vast, immeasurable, illimitable cemetery. Oh my. That sounds morbid, doesn't it? He says, it is a domain of death. It is a region of darkness. You being dead in your sins. What he says, you need to understand that outside of Christ, you are dead and hopeless and you're going to hell. That's the destination for your eternal soul. That's clear. That's the representation that Paul gives to every human being, is that we outside of Christ are lost and we are going to an eternal damnation, eternal lake of fire, eternal hell.
That's right.
Now, that's a serious note. That's a serious truth that is from the Old Testament through to the New Testament. And it's so important because there's so many people misled in our world today. And so many people, unfortunately, are going to go to heaven one day and they're going to stand before God as their judge and they're going to say, look at all that we did. He's going to say, depart from me, I never knew you. Because it's not about what you did, it's about who you know.
Amen.
And outside of Christ, we are destitute. We owe a terrible sin debt and there's no chance that we could ever pay it. Ecclesiastes chapter 7 verse 20 says, for there is not a just man upon earth that does good and sins not. Not one. It's pretty clear.
Yeah.
You say, well, old so-and-so, he's pretty good. He might be a good person. Listen, I'm going to tell you what. There are a lot of good moral people outside of Christ. There are sometimes there are, the people outside of the church are sometimes more moral than the people in the church. Amen? That's a shame, but that's true. Shouldn't be, but it is. But listen, just because you're a good person doesn't mean you know Christ.
That's right.
Doesn't mean anything when it comes to standing before the Lord. Ephesians chapter 2 verse 1 and 2 says, and you were dead in your trespasses and sins in which you previously, he's talking to the believers, you previously walked according to the ways of this world, according to the ruler, the power of the air, the spirit now working in the disobedient. He said that's where you were. You were lost, you were undone, you were sinful, and you were headed for destruction. That's a terrible revelation. But it's necessary to understand that truth. In Romans chapter 3, verse 23, probably most everybody in here can quote this verse. Then the Bible says, for all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. That means every one of us are sinners. Not only were we born with a sin nature, we have sinned. Now, it'd be embarrassing and shameful if we had to play a video and share before the whole congregation all of our sins. We'd all run and hide. Amen? We'd never set foot in this church again if we showed all of our sinfulness. But the truth is, God knows. And you know. And one day you will stand before God and give an account. And what you will have to give an account to God for is all of that sinfulness. All your sin nature and all your bad choices, unless those sins are covered by the blood of Jesus.
Amen.
In Romans 6:23, the Bible says not only, as it said in 3:23, that all have sinned. In 6:23 it says the wages of sin is death. There's a price to be paid. There's a day of reckoning coming. And one day you're going to stand before God and be judged for your sin and your sinfulness. Because of our sins, we have accrued a terrible, terrible debt. You imagine going to a bank and you go every day and you draw out money every day because you are trying to survive, and what you understand is that there is this terrible debt and it just continues to get greater. You started out with a great debt and it just continues to grow because you keep making withdrawals. You keep making loans. You keep borrowing. And you know there's never any way you can ever pay it back. And that's the representation, the symbolism, the spiritual imagery that Paul says for us. We are spiritually bankrupt without Jesus. We have such a debt that there is not a, pardon the phrase, there's not a prayer in this world that we could ever pay it back. We could labor every day of our life and every breath that we breathe and try to repay or make right the wrongs that we have done, let alone the sin nature that we have, and we would still, at the end of our life, still owe a great debt that we could never repay. So you need someone to pay your debt for you. That's the only hope you have of being out of debt. And that's the good news.
Yeah.
And that's what we find in our text. And that's what the gospel is all about. And that's what we see. Letter B. And that is, He paid the debt that He didn't owe. He paid the debt that He didn't owe. He paid our debt for us. I don't know what happened. I don't know if it's not on the flash drive or if it's blank or what. But anyway, there's that point. Letter B is, He paid our debt for us. Amen? Aren't you thankful for that?
Amen.
That debt that we could not pay, Jesus Christ paid on our behalf. He paid for us.
Thank the Lord.
He canceled it. He wiped it out. He erased our sins' debt. Now, here's what I want you to understand. It's not just that God said, well, you know, I feel good about them. They're a pretty good person. I think I'll just forgive their debt. You ever had somebody that owed you something and you just said, I'm not ever going to collect, so out of the kindness of my heart, I'm just going to forgive that debt. That's not what God did. That would violate His holiness and His righteousness. That would violate the laws already established. God did not just say, I'm going to forgive their debt. The debt had to be paid because the debt was owed. And you could not pay the debt, so someone had to pay your debt for you. And that's what Jesus did on the cross. Jesus paid your sins' debt for you when He died on the cross for your sins, not His.
Thank God.
In those days, a certificate of debt was written on parchment and could easily be wiped away after it was paid in full. But Paul says that the believer's debt has been washed away like the ink on that whiteboard. Christ has delivered us from the penalty of our sin on the cross, and He broke the power of sin over us. Isn't that good? Paul illustrates this complete forgiveness even more. He says, God wiped away our certificate of debt with its obligations. So not only did we have a debt, then there was a great obligation we had because of that debt. And the law was hanging over our head and we could not fulfill it. And He says, Christ fulfilled that debt and all of its obligations. He paid it all. We are in debt to God because of the law, and Christ fulfilled the law and paid that debt on our behalf. In biblical times, when a person was crucified, I read that his crimes, as you know, were nailed above the cross, or nailed above him on the cross. Remember what they did with Jesus? They nailed a sign above his head, said, King of the Jews. Well, the Jewish leader said, no, change that. Say, He says He's the King of the Jews. No, it stands. It's going to stay. Because that was the only crime that Jesus committed was saying he was king of the Jews. Remember, Jesus didn't die for his sins, he died for our sins. And so the sign nailed above him was king of the Jews. Well, what Paul says in our text, get this, it's a beautiful picture because you have to tie it together. What he says is what God did when Jesus died on the cross is God took your sins' debt. He took that certificate of debt, that recording of your sin's life and your debt, and he took that over to the cross and he nailed it on the cross. That's what Jesus did when he died for you. He paid your sin's debt and God nailed it to the cross, never to see it again. Amen?
Amen.
Isn't that good?
Yeah.
That's a beautiful picture of what Christ did on your behalf. He paid your sin's debt. You can't earn it. You can't pay it. He paid it for you. It's already done. You just receive it and live in it. In Romans chapter 8, verse 1, it says, there, one of my favorite verses, I love this verse, memorized it a long, long time ago because, man, it was so inspirational. Such a big help for me. It says, therein, in the King James, therein there is therefore now no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. It's a beautiful passage of Scripture. You know, truth is there's a difference between condemnation and conviction. Conviction is something that the Spirit of God does in us to draw us to God. So often, though, we resist that conviction and we run away from God. Whereas condemnation is something that the enemy uses to really pull us away from God. The enemy says, hey, remember this? Hey, remember this? And he continuously brings up our failures and our sins and our faults. That's condemnation. The beautiful thing for a believer, as Romans 8:1 says, there is now no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. That's a beautiful promise. I love that truth. Amen? Anytime the devil raises his head in my ugly face, in my face, his ugly head in my face, either way you're going to take it, all is appropriate. And all I got to say is, hey, praise God, it's all covered in the blood. There is no condemnation. Amen?
Amen.
Debt's paid. Debt is paid in full. And that's the beautiful truth. Now, I want to share with you an illustration in closing. And then there's some images. Oh, do y'all have the images? Are they not there either? They are there. Okay, I'm seeing a thumb, but I'm not seeing anything. Okay, we'll get to them in a second. Let me remind you quickly of the song. There we go. Number 3 ain't there? Oh, man, I don't know what happened. All right. Y'all remember the song, Jesus Paid Some of It, right? No, it doesn't say that. Jesus paid it all. All to Him I owe. Sin had left the crimson stain. He washed it white as snow. And when before the throne I stand in Him complete, Jesus died my soul to save. My lips shall still repeat. What's it say? Jesus paid it all. He paid it all. Don't you ever forget it. Baptism is a representation of what Jesus did in your life already. That's not accomplishing it. It's a symbol. Jesus paid it all.
Amen.
On August the 7th, 2007, Barry Bonds hit a home run. Number 756. The home run that broke Hank Aaron's record. And sports buffs say that the recording should be accompanied by an asterisk. The asterisk should, of course, means that the record is sort of a record. A footnoted record. The asterisk should, means that the record is tainted, and that is because there is the alleged abuse and use of steroids by Barry Bonds. Now, Mark Echo, the man who bought the ball that Bonds sent and lost into the air that became home run 756, asked the baseball fans in an internet poll, what should he do with it? The fans voted for him to brand the baseball with the asterisk and donate it to the Baseball Hall of Fame. And in the summer of 2008, that is exactly what Echo did. So number 756 has that little mark on the inside there that is visible. Interesting. The Bible informs us that there's a book of life in which the names of each believer is recorded. With all the sins that we have committed in this life, you would expect that beside each of our names there should be an asterisk. Tainted. Don't belong. Undeserved. But so great is our justification in Jesus Christ, and so perfect is His work on the cross, and so wonderful is His love and His grace and His mercy, that in the book of life, beside your name, if you are a believer in Jesus Christ, there will be no asterisk. Amen. It'll just list your name as a child of God, because the debt has been paid in full.
Thank the Lord.
Amen? Amen. Let's see the next couple of images, and then we're going to close in prayer. I love it. There's the check. Paid in full. Whosoever believeth in me has everlasting life. Because I love you. Signed, Jesus Christ, paid in full. Isn't that good? I didn't come up with that. I found it, so I had to share it. And then, did you accept Jesus' payment for your sins? Or, and catch this question. Or, are you foolish enough to pay for them yourself? Remember, it's a debt you can't pay. I'd hate to be in that position where I rejected and refused Christ's debt cancellation. And finally, let us live like we are worth the price that He paid. Amen?
Amen.
Let's close in prayer. Father, thank You for loving us. Thank You for sending Jesus Christ to die on that cruel cross. Not for His sins, not for the things that He did, but for my sins, for the things that I did. For my sinful nature and all the times that I did wrong. I'm so thankful that He saw fit to endure the cross and all of its punishment and pay my sins debt in full. Lord, I know that I owe You. I owe You my life. I made that decision so many years ago to faithfully follow You, to trust You. Lord, I'm so thankful for those in this service that have done the same. Thankful for Cynthia, who's going to come in just a moment and demonstrate that same decision and commitment and obedience to You by her public demonstration of that with baptism. Lord, there's a chance that there's one, even if there's just one in this service today, that if they were to die right here and now, they would stand before You condemned because their sin debt is still owed. They haven't trusted in Jesus. They haven't cried out to You for Your salvation. They haven't repented of their sins. They haven't turned to You and said, God, forgive me and save me. God, I pray that today would be the day, that this would be the very hour that they would come and kneel and pray, turn from their wicked ways and put their trust in You, O God, and receive full pardon. Debt paid in full because of Jesus' wonderful redemptive work on the cross. God, may You do Your work in our hearts. May You challenge us to honor You with our lives. May You minister now in these closing moments, we pray in Jesus' name. I'm asking you to stand. Mark is going to lead us in a song of invitation. Miss Cynthia, if you will go. Miss Kathy, I'll help you get ready for a baptism. I'm going to step out. Please stay and participate in this baptism service. Just let the Spirit of God minister to you. And if He is dealing with you, and you need to make that decision today, you step forward. I'm sure one of our men or women would come and pray with you and lead you in the Lord. Please don't leave here today without your sins debt being paid.
Action. Please be seated.